Hi guys, my name is PJ Bridger. I'm a Roland product specialist in Europe, and I'm really excited to be here today to show you the SP404 Mark II. Roland SP samplers are the ultimate in performance-based beat making. They're famous for their distinctive sound and their ability to create tracks anywhere you go. The SP404 Mark II is our best SP sampler to date. It's perfect for sample-based producers, instrumentalists, finger drummers, or artists of any style who want intuitive, portable hardware for beat creation and performance. As I'm sure you guys are aware, the SP range has a great heritage, to the point where it has an almost cult following. So because of this, we worked very hard in development to make sure the new model stayed true to its predecessors. Inside the SP404 Mark II box, you will get an AC adapter, a README first leaflet, a quick start guide, and also a registration card with a QR code on it that will link to the Roland website. Use this card to register at roland.com to receive emails on firmware updates and other SP related news. The first thing you'll want to do before jumping into song making is to make sure you have the latest firmware from Roland for any bug fixes or additional features. To check the firmware version currently installed on your unit, press Shift and Pad 13, and then choose System, and use the Control 3 knob to scroll to the far right of the menu to the Version tab. To update your unit's firmware, download the firmware update from the Roland product page. This will be labeled System Program. Then copy the downloaded bin file to the SD card. Hold Shift when powering on to start the update. Then power off your unit. After the update is done, perform a factory reset by pressing Shift and Pad 13 and then choosing Factory Reset. Use the Value knob to select all data. If you are performing a firmware update at a later point, you can use the System Data option to keep your sample library intact. The new SP404 Mark II uses a generic USB driver, so there's no need to download an additional driver. The SP will work straight away when connected to a computer. I will cover using the SP with a computer in the section Using with a DAW. As with previous models, the SP404 Mark II can still be powered by six AA batteries or the included AC adapter, but now you can also use USB bus power. This means you can power directly from a laptop, a wall outlet with a USB-C plug adapter, or from a 1.5 amp USB-C mobile battery. Got my mobile battery here. It should be noted when powering from USB, you always need to use USB-C to USB-C. As you can see, the new model stays true to the SP form factor. And if you're an existing user of the SP404SX or SP404A, you'll be familiar with the layout. However, there are a lot of great upgrades in the new model, and one of the most obvious is we now have this awesome OLED screen. At first glance, it looks like the traditional SP404 display showing the BPM, but as you will see when I'm going through the new features, this upgraded screen allows for much more control, especially when it comes to sample editing and using the effects. As you can see, we still have the six classic effects buttons for your favorite effects and the three control knobs at the top of the unit. This mirrors the setup of the previous SP404 models, but now the effects buttons are fully customizable and there is now a total of four effects buses, allowing you complete control when setting up your effects section. The original SP404 had 13 pads, 12 performance pads and the sub pad. But now we have an awesome 17 pads for triggering your sample. That's 16 pads plus the sub pad. These pads are velocity sensitive and a massive upgrade from the previous SP models. allowing for incredibly accurate finger drumming and live performances. Alongside this, the new unit has 32 note polyphony, so you will never have a sample get cut off again. On the previous SP404A, you had 10 banks. Each of these banks could hold 12 samples. So that is a maximum of 120 samples on the unit. In the new Mark II, not only have we increased the samples per bank from 12 to 16, we have also added projects. A project is one level up from a bank. And on the new SP, you have access to 16. So now you have 16 projects, each with 10 banks of 16 samples. That means now you can fit an amazing 2,560 samples on the new model. At Roland, we know that being able to add your own touch to your SP is very important to the community. So we have retained the removable faceplate to allow for easy customization to give your unit its own independent design. We now also have customizable startup screens for your own logo, for example, and customizable screensavers, so you can really make your SP your own. So let's do a quick rundown of the hardware itself. On the front of the unit, you have two headphone outputs for both 3.5mm and 1/4-inch headphone sizes. There is also a 1/4-inch jack input on the front, with a switch allowing you to choose between guitar or mic level input. On the back of the unit, you have the Kensington anti-theft slot, two stereo 1/4-inch jacks for line in and line out, TRS MIDI in and out, USB Type-C for power or data connectivity, and also your power supply input. When you first turn on your SP, you will start in the top level menu. This is also known as sample playback mode. When in this mode, you can trigger your sounds by pressing any one of the 16 pads. If you press a pad and then press hold, you can hear the entire sample without continuing to press the pad. To stop playback, simply press hold again or press the pad that is playing. At the moment, we are in the first bank. Bank A. You can see this as the bank A and F button is illuminated. To move to another bank, just press one of the other bank buttons. This will load up that bank. In this case, bank B, which has a completely different set of samples on each pad. Each of the bank buttons is actually able to select two banks. For example, if I press bank B twice, I will actually open up bank G. You will notice this because the bank button is flashing here to indicate we are on the second bank. So, if you've just got your SP out of the box, you probably want to get straight on with creating a beat. There are several ways to do this, but the first way I'm going to show you is by using the pattern sequencer. So, let's go to pattern select mode. From here, all the pads will start to blink on and off in purple. To play one of the patterns, just press a pad. To stop it playing, press the pad again. If you would like to link from one pattern to the next pattern, just press a pad when the current pattern is playing. It will begin to flash, indicating it has been chosen to play next. The current pattern will continue to play until the end of the sequence, and then it will automatically play the next pattern. In this example, I'm going to show you how to record a new pattern, which includes deleting a pattern. If you do not want to delete any of the pre-installed patterns, there is an empty bank in bank J, which you can use. But we want to create our own pattern, so we're going to delete the data from pad number 16. To do this, press delete and then pad 16. You will then see the delete button starts to flash. To confirm, just press enter to delete the pattern. As you can see, now pad 16 is not illuminated, which means we can record our new pattern to this pad. To record a new pattern onto this pad, press record and then choose the pad we want to record to. As you can see, pad 16 is flashing as it's our only free pad to record to. Press pad 16 and then the recording settings screen will open where we can change several parameters for the pattern we're about to record to. You can change the BPM using control 1. I'm going to leave it at 84 because that's the speed my samples are. You can change the length of the recording by using control knob 2. I'm going to leave this at 2 bars. And you can also apply quantization to your input using control 3. Quantization will mean that if you play out of time, the SP will adjust your input to match a grid value that you have already set. You can adjust the grid value by using the value knob. You can also adjust the strength by using the control 3 knob. The strength amount will define how much quantization is added. If you want your recorded inputs to be readjusted to be exactly on the grid, you can use a value of 100%. If you want no quantize at all, you can leave the value at 0%. I would like my inputs to be adjusted slightly, so I'm going to use a value of around 60%. It is important to set the quantization setting before recording, as it's only available for your inputs and cannot be added afterwards. When you are happy with your settings, press record again to start your recording. I'm now going to enter some hi-hats into my pattern. Okay, I'm now going to press exit to stop my recording. So now we can see that pad 16 is illuminated, which indicates we've now recorded a pattern to that pad. If we press the pad again, we can hear our recorded hi-hats. But we don't want to just stop there. We want to record some more drums in as well. So let's press record again and press pad 16 to add more to our hi-hat pattern. So now we're in record settings and we press record again to overdub a snare into our pattern. Okay, so now we have a snare in our pattern. As you can see, if I don't exit out, the pattern will continue to loop around in record mode. If we touch any more pads at this point, they would be recorded into our pattern. But what we can do is press record again to enter rehearsal mode. Now we can play the pads and choose our next sample without it being entered into the pattern. When you've found the sound you want, press record again and you can record it into the pattern. So, I didn't really like that kick pattern and I want to record it again. You may have noticed on the left side of the screen, there are boxes that fill in each time you press a pad. This is one of the really cool new features of the Mark II. We now have undo. So these boxes are counting the amount of undo steps that we have available. So if I hold shift and press pattern select, I can undo some of the kicks that I've recorded into my pattern, which is a really cool new feature. Also, alternatively, I can press delete to enter erase mode and the pads will light up blue. In erase mode, I can delete sounds I've entered into the pattern by holding the pad down whilst the pattern is playing. You can actually see the sounds you've already recorded into the pattern as the pads will light up as the sound is triggered. So I want to delete the kicks I've entered in, so I just hold down the pad whilst the kicks are playing, and then we can press delete again to return to recording mode. Now let's record our kicks in again. So now we have a cool drum loop. So I want to add some samples over the top, so we enter rehearsal mode again by pushing record, and then we can choose our next sound. So I really like this sound on pad 4 and also the sound on pad 3, so I'm going to record them into the pattern. So I press record again and enter the sounds into my pattern. So I think that sounds really cool, and I'm now just going to add the bass, which is on pad 1. So there you go, guys. That is how you use the pattern sequencer. If you would like to make changes to your pattern, you can press the pattern edit screen. In here, you can change the BPM using Control 1 or the length using Control 3. You can also use the menu to duplicate or crop your pattern. When you've created several patterns in the pattern sequencer, you can use the pattern chain function to play these back in a sequence. To do this, first press pattern select. As you can see, I have some patterns already in here. Now, to enter pattern chain mode, press and hold the hold button. Here you can see now that the pads flash green. This indicates that you're choosing a pattern chain slot. You can save a different pattern chain slot to each one of the 16 pads. I'm going to choose pad 1. Here you can see the pattern chain menu has opened up. Now we can just press the patterns in the order we want them to play. After you've entered your patterns, you can use the Remain button to choose whether the pattern chain will repeat the whole sequence, repeat the currently playing pattern, or end at the end of your pattern chain. You can then just press the sub pad to play back your selection. If for some reason you want to remove a pattern from the chain, you can move through with the value knob and then delete using the delete button. In total, you can have 16 patterns in the chain and they will be automatically saved with your project. You can also resample your pattern chains to a pad to continue to work on or to use in your live performances. To do this, press pattern select, then press resample, and then choose a pad to record to. I'm going to go to our empty bank, bank J, and choose pad 1. Then when you're back in your pattern select screen, hold hold, and choose the pattern chain you would like to record. I'm going to choose pattern chain 1. Then you just press the sub pad to start the recording. After your pattern chain has completed, press the record button to finish the resample. You will then see your sequence has been recorded to a pad for you to work with further. At this point, it may not be obvious why resampling to a pad would be useful, but don't worry because I'm going to cover that in the next section, the resampling method. Now I'm going to show you what is arguably the most popular way of creating songs on the SP. It's definitely my favourite way of working, and that is the resample method. So the first thing I've done is gone to an empty bank. Bank J is empty by default. And then I've found some sounds from the other banks on the SP and moved them to this bank to create a new song. So here I have some drum samples, and I also have an instrument loop. For the instrument loop, I'm going to press exit 4 times to stop it. This is the command to stop all sounds playing on the SP. So let me show you how you can move files around like this. I like a vocal sample that I have in bank E. So if I now press the copy button, it will bring up the copy menu. And now I can press pad 16 in bank E, which is the sound I want to copy. I can move over to bank J and I can put it in pad 16 in bank J. And here on the display, you can see we're moving E16 to J16. And then all we have to do is push in the value knob to confirm. And now we've moved that sound from bank E to bank J. The resample method will record whatever we play into the device. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to play the sample and then record the drums over the top. So first of all, we press the resample button and the SP asks us which pad we'd like to record to. I'm going to choose pad 2. And as you can see on the display, it says press pad to start. So as soon as we press a pad now, the SP will start the resample. When we finish the resample, we press record to end the recording. And now, as you can see, pad 2 is illuminated, which shows that we've recorded something to that pad. And when we press that pad, we will hear the recording that we just created with the sample and the drums. From here, guys, you can just keep resampling to new pads and layering up your samples and recordings to make a full song. So, the pattern sequencer and the resample methods are two ways to create songs on the SP. Each way has its own advantages. For example, if you use the pattern sequencer, you can always go back and add or remove sounds and create multiple patterns and chain these patterns together to make full songs. Using the resample method will be the most familiar method for most people who have used previous SP models. And it allows you to be creative and resample loops with additional effects, which you can record in real time and overdub several times to create really unique samples. It is up to you which way you work, and for me, a combination of both is usually the best. Now we are going to talk about the different options you have available to you to record into the SP Mark II. On the front of the unit, you have a quarter inch jack input with a switch, allowing you to choose between guitar or mic. And on the back of the unit, you have two quarter inch jacks and a USB port. Right now, we're going to record my JU06A using the line in inputs on the back of the SP. The external source button is where we can monitor any sound that's coming into the SP from any input, including the mic and guitar input or the USB. So if we press the external source button and we play the Juno, we can hear the sound coming into the SP from the line inputs on the back. If we want to change any settings, we can press Shift and external source to access the input settings screen. Here we can change the BPM with control knob 1. You can use control 2 to change the routing of the recording from external in to mix. External in will just record the external signal coming in, but mix will record everything that's happening on the SP. And then control 3 allows you to change the input level. I'm going to be playing my beat and then recording the bass line over the top, and I want to capture everything that's going on, so I'm going to leave it on mix. To back out of this menu, just press the exit button. So now let's press resample and choose a pad to record to. I'm going to record to pad 3. Now we are ready to record as soon as I press a pad. So I'm going to get ready with my left hand to press the pad with my beat and my sample and use my right hand to play in the bass line. Then just press the record button to finish the resample. And as you can see, pad 3 is illuminated, which means we've just recorded to this pad. You can now press the pad to hear the beat, the sample, and the bass line all together. If you would just like to record a sample, for example, a piece of music from a record, you can use the record function rather than the resample function. For this example, I'm going to use another awesome feature of the SP Mark II, which is the fact you can record over USB. So I'm going to record from my iPhone using an Apple Camera Connection Kit and a USB-C cable into the back of the SP. So then we can just press the external source button and we can press play on the iPhone to hear the audio coming from the iPhone into the SP. So next we press recording, and first of all what I'm going to do is go into the recording settings screen. So then we just push in the value knob and we can add some input effects to our audio coming from the iPhone. So I'm going to press play on the iPhone, and then I'm going to push in enter, and you can go through the effects. Loads of really cool input effects here. And I'm going to choose the 303 vinyl simulator, which adds a classic vinyl simulation over the top of our audio, making it sound like it's from a record. So now if I exit out of this screen and exit out again, now I can choose a pad I want to record to. I'm already in our empty bank, Bank J, so I'm just going to choose pad 1. And now I'm going to move my iPhone back to the start of the audio. And then I'm just going to press record, wait for the countdown, and then press play on my iPhone. And then press record again to end the recording. And as you can see now, pad 1 is illuminated, which means we've recorded something to that pad. And if we press the pad, we can hear our sample recorded from the iPhone with the input effects on top. And there you go, we have our sample recorded in from our iPhone using the USB cable with our vinyl sim effect on top of it. Of course, if you are doing a recording using the mic or line input on the front of the SP, you can use the same steps that I just used to capture your recording. There is actually another way to capture sounds from your SP, and it is one of my favorite new features, and that is skip back. So skip back is a feature that in a way is constantly recording what the SP is doing. It remembers the last 25 seconds of the master output and allows you to recall that audio. You can see when skip back has been activated because the mark button will glow. And to activate it, all you do is press the mark button and it will load up your audio. So let me give you an example. I'm just going to mess around here and play some little drum beats. So I like the last one that I just played there, so if I just press the mark button, and there we go, we now have the drum beats I just played as recorded audio, and you can trigger the audio by pressing the sub pad. So the drum beat that I liked was actually the last one, so I can use Control 1 to move the start point over here, and I can use Control 3 to move the end point, and then if I press in the value knob and I choose truncate from the menu, it will remove all the audio from the outside and leave me with my drum loop. Now we can just press record and choose an empty pad to assign our sample. I'm going to choose pad 1. And now when we press pad 1, we will have my skip back drum loop that I have recorded to that pad. So I've covered how to get sounds into your SP, and now I'm going to show you how you can edit your sounds. Here we have the sample that I just recorded using skip back. And if I press the start end button, we can see that on the OLED screen. So now I can use the control one knob to adjust the start point. After you use the control knob, you can use the value knob to zoom in really close and get a really nice, precise start point. Then we can zoom back out and we can use the control 3 knob to set the endpoint. If I now turn off gate and turn on loop, we can start the sample playing and continuing to loop, and we can adjust the loop point. So if I zoom back out now, the loop point is here, and I can use Control 2 to bring that back to the start. And now I can just adjust the end point, zoom in a bit, so it loops perfectly. There we go, that sounds good to me. Then we can press the value knob and truncate the audio again. And there we go, we have our perfect drum loop on pad one. There are a few useful shortcuts you can use when you're in the start end menu. If I first choose a sample and then open the start end menu, and then if I turn off gate and turn on loop, we can see that our loop point is in the middle of the sample. Now, if I take control one and move the start point, as you can see, when it hits the loop point, it will actually move the loop point. If you've already spent some time defining your loop point, you may not want this to happen. As you can see, the remain button is flashing, and now if we press it, the light will turn on. This means that our loop point is now locked in position, and now if I move my start point, it will no longer move past my loop point. Sometimes you will be playing a long sample, and when you're trying to set the endpoint, it's frustrating to have to listen to the entire sample each time you make an adjustment. But now you can actually just press the roll button and the sample will play the last 4 seconds of audio, making it much easier to set your endpoint. So now we know how to record a sample into the SP and loop it. Now I'm going to show you how you can chop a sample into smaller pieces so you can play around with it to create a new melody or rhythm. So first, we want to choose a sample that we want to chop up. I'm going to use the sample that I just recorded in from my iPhone earlier. Then I'm going to press Shift and Start End to enter the chop menu. There are several ways that you can chop a sample. The first way is by manually entering the chop marks yourself. To do this, you press the first pad and it will start to play the sample. Then during the sample, you can press the next pad and it will enter a new mark every time you hit a new pad. Let's try that now. So now we can trigger the sample at different points by pressing each of the pads. Now, if we want to change a location of one of these marks, we can use Control 3 to select a mark. And then we can use Control 2 to move that mark around. You can also use Control 1 to manually enter marks. As you can see, when I move the knob, the cursor moves through the sample, and then I can just press the mark button to enter a new mark into my sample. You can also delete markers by selecting them with Control 3 and pressing delete. So now we have our sample chopped. We want to assign those chops to pads on the SP. To do this, we press Enter to go into the menu and then choose the option Assign to Pad. Here, we can choose the pads we would like our chops to be assigned to. The empty pads are highlighted in green. So for my first mark, I'm going to choose pad 5. You can see here now mark 1 is assigned to J5. I'm then going to use the Control 2 knob to move to my next sample. I'm going to assign that. Pad 6, and so on. We can also use Control Knob 3 here to check if our samples are gated or not. I'm going to leave the gate off. And then we just press in the value knob to confirm our assignment. And there we go. As you can see, our sample is now chopped to these pads. The other way to chop a sample is to use the auto mark option. So if we choose our sample and then enter the chop menu, we can then press in the value knob and choose auto mark from the menu. Here we can then choose from entering marks using time division. At the moment I have time division on 8, so this means it would chop the sample into 8 equal size parts. You can change this value using the Control 3 knob. This can be useful for chopping quantized drum patterns, for example. We can use the value knob to choose a different auto mark mode. Here we have the level option. The level option allows us to add a number of marks depending on the level of the audio signal. The higher the number, the more finely divided the audio will be. We can also chop our audio by using the transient option. This will enter marks at the transient points. Transient points are points which have a high amplitude, for example, drum hits. We can choose between hard, which will have a high sensitivity, mid, which will be a medium sensitivity, and soft, which will be the lowest sensitivity. For this sample, I'm going to choose soft, so it just grabs the main transients. We can then press enter by pressing in the value knob, and it will analyze our sample. Again, in the same way we edited the mark points in manual mode, we can still move these marker points around and add and delete them as we see fit. These marks look fine to me, so I'm going to continue. Now we are going to assign our markers to pads again, but this time we are going to use the auto assign. So we go into our menu by pressing in the value knob, choose assign to a pad, and then now you can use the value knob to choose which pad you want to start your auto assign from. So I want to assign my samples in 9, 10, 11, and 12, and I am in Bank J. So you can use the value knob to change the number here in the mark section. So I want to change that to J9, and then this will assign the samples in Bank J on 9, 10, 11, and 12. If you want to, you can switch to another bank and choose to assign there, but I'm going to stay in Bank J. You need to be careful when using this method as it will overwrite samples if you choose pads that are not empty. You can easily see which pads are empty because they will be illuminated in green. You now just press mark to choose auto assign, and as you can see, it's assigned the samples on 9, 10, 11, and 12. Now I just press enter, and as you can see, pads 9, 10, 11, 12 are illuminated. And now when we press these pads, we will hear our chopped up sample. Now I'm going to tell you about the pitch and speed menu. So let's choose a sample and open up the menu. In here, you can change the volume of a sound by using Control 3. And you can change the speed of a sound by using Control 1. In the SP, there are two different time stretching algorithms. The first is vinyl mode on. This will lower the pitch of the sound as you decrease the speed and increase the pitch when the sound is playing faster, similar to using the pitch on a vinyl turntable. The second is with vinyl mode off, which will allow you to change the pitch and the speed of the time stretch independently. To switch in between these modes, hold the shift button and turn the value knob. With the shift button pressed, you can also change the panning from left to to right, and if you go all the way to one side, you can actually make the sound mono, which is great for drum loops. In the pitch and speed menu, you can also analyze your sample and auto detect its BPM. You do this by going into the menu by pressing the value knob. Within this menu, you can choose the BPM range to scan. This helps to avoid auto detecting at half time or at double speed. So for this sample, I think it's around the 80 BPM range. So I'm going to choose 70 to 139. Then I'm going to press in the value knob to auto detect our BPM. Press OK. And there we go, it has detected that my sample is 76.5 BPM. On the rare occasion that the SP detects the wrong BPM, or you want to change the BPM to your taste, you can use the value knob to select manual. If you then press in the value knob, you'll be able to choose whatever BPM you like. There is a secondary menu to the pitch speed button, and that is envelope mode. If I choose a sample, then I press shift and pitch speed, it will bring up the envelope mode. In here, we can use control one to adjust a sample's attack, which is how long it takes to get to full volume. Using control two, we can adjust the hold, which is how long the sample plays for. And using control three, we can adjust the release, which is how long the sample takes to fade out. I am now going to take you through the sample mode section. The first button is BPM sync. At the moment, our sample is 77 BPM, which you can see on the screen here. With BPM sync on, our sample will be stretched to the BPM of the bank. The BPM of the bank is set in the tap tempo menu, which you can access by pressing shift and pad 11. So now if I use the value knob to change this value here, I'm going to change it to 80 BPM and then exit out, you can see my sample has also changed to 80 BPM. The bank BPM affects all the samples within the bank, as the name suggests. So this makes it very easy to sync groups of samples together so they all play at the same speed. I'm going to show these next parameters with this start end mode on, so you can see a visual representation of the changes that are made with the different settings. So first, let's choose our sample, then press start end. The next button in sample mode is gate. With gate off, the entire sample will be played when you press the pad. With gate on, the sample will only play for the amount of time you hold down the pad. To turn gate on or off for all samples in a bank at the same time, press shift and gate. Next is the loop button. With the loop button off, your sample will play till the end and then stop. With loop on, your sample will play till the end and then start again from the start, or from the loop point which you've already set up. If you press shift and loop, you will enable ping pong looping. This means that the sample will play forwards, and then when it reaches the end, it will play backwards. When the reverse button is activated, the sample will play backwards. A cool tip with this is you can play the sample backwards and then disable reverse while it's playing and it will play forwards. I'm now going to exit out of the menu to show you roll mode. If you press and hold the roll button and play a sample, the sample will repeat. I'm just going to turn on gate mode. You can change the timing of the roll by pressing Shift and Roll. At the top of the SPE, we have our top 5 effects and also our assignable MFX button. For the assignable MFX button, there is a list of 32 effects to choose from. To choose which effects you have assigned to the MFX button, press and hold the button and then use the value knob, or Control 3, or the corresponding pad to choose which effects you'd like to select. For example, if I want this lo-fi effect, which is at the bottom of the list, number 16, I press pad 16. There is also a second page containing the additional 16 effects. You can get to this by using the value knob, or you can use Control 3, or if you're on the first page, you can actually press DJ Effects Looper and jump directly to the second page, and then you can use the pads to choose the effects you would like. So for example, if I want this overdrive effect, I will choose pad 13. To turn on an effect, simply play your sample and then press the effects button. So I'm going to choose this sample, sample 4, then just press filter drive to turn it on. You can also do an effects grab, which makes the effect momentary by pressing in and holding the value knob and then pushing the effects button in. The 3 control knobs at the top of the SP are used to change an effect's parameters. You can also often access a second row of parameters by pressing in the value knob. If there is an arrow below a parameter, this indicates there is a second row of effects available. After using a control knob to change a parameter, the menu will stay on the screen for a short time before disappearing. Whilst in the effects menu, if you press and hold the remain button and then press the effects button, the effects menu will stay active until you remove the effect. When you activate an effect, by default, it will affect all of the pads that are playing. Sometimes you will be in a situation where you only want certain pads to be sent to the effect. To choose if a pad gets sent to the effect or not, press and hold the remain button and then press the pad. The pad will then change from orange to white. This indicates that that pad is no longer being sent to the effect. You can turn the effects on or off for all pads in a bank by pressing and holding the remain button and then pressing the bank button. On the new SP, there is now a bust effects button. This gives us access to a second level of effects from the top menu. By default, we are on bus 1. To add an effect to this bus, just choose an effect. So I'm going to be using this sample, and I'm going to add filter drive. To access bus 2, just press the bus effects button and you will see the screen will tell us we're on bus 2. Also, the bus effects button will flash indicating that we are on bus 2. Also, you'll notice that our filter drive button is not activated, but if I play our sample, you will hear that the filter drive is still on the sample. So now we're in bus 2, we can add a second effect. I'm going to use my MFX button, which is my assignable effect, and I'm going to choose tape echo. So now if I play my sample, we will hear it going through the filter drive and then through the tape echo. We can now use the bus effects button to move between our two buses and take effects on or off or change the settings. We'll be right back. You can swap the two assigned effects by holding the Remain button and pressing Bus Effects. We can also use the Remain button to choose whether our sounds go to one or both of the effects. If the pad is illuminated orange, the sound is going to both effects. If we press the Remain button and press the pad while on bus 1, we will remove both of the effects. This is shown by the pad lighting up white. But what if we want to just add the second effect? Well, we can do this if we move to bus 2 and then press the Remain button and the pad again, and this will add just the second effect. You can see this by the pad lighting up green. To enter the EFX menu, press Shift and pad 16. Here you can see your effects routings. You can press in the value knob to change the routing type. And if we turn the value knob, we can add two additional effects buses, bus 3 and bus 4. This will add an additional two effects in your effects chain. If you add these effects, they are always on, and you can only change the effects settings from this menu. Using the value knob, you can scroll through and access 16 different effects bus settings. These are known as your favorite routings. So let's check some of these out. I'm going to play my sample and scroll through. When you have a favorite routing selected, let's just take note of our effects on bus 3 here, equalizer. We can then use Control 3 to scroll through the tabs at the top and access bus 3 and bus 4. So here we are on bus 3, and you can choose a different effect from the menu. There's loads of different effects here to choose from. To select the effects, just push the value knob in, and then you can use the value knob to move down to the next level of the menu. From here, these parameters can be adjusted by using the control knobs at the top of the SP. We can then scroll back up with the value knob and use the control 3 knob to go back to our routings. And you can see that bus 3 has now been changed. In addition to this, another awesome feature on the new SP is now all of the top 5 effects are also customizable. If we use control 3 to scroll across to the Direct tab, we can actually change the effects that are assigned to each of the top 5 effects buttons. So now you can create your own personal top 5 layout that is perfectly suited for your own style. There are several bank functions that are very useful shortcuts. First, you have Shift and Bank. This allows you to change the overall volume of an entire bank. But of course, you can still go in and change the volume of single sounds. You also have Shift and Gate. This will turn gate on or off for all sounds in a bank. And there is also Shift and Copy. This allows you to protect a bank. This locks the sound from any changes. This is a useful function, especially for people who are performing live. This makes sure that their live set stays protected from accidental changes. If you press a pad and then press and hold the Remain button, you'll get a lot of information about that pad. You can scroll through the menu by using the value knob. This is very useful to quickly check the settings of the current pad without having to go through several different menus. The sub pad will always trigger the last pad that was played. For example, if I press this pad and then press the sub pad, it will play that sample. But then if I press this pad and then press the sub pad, it will play that sample. the sub pad can be used for performance techniques like this. On the SP, you can use different modes and functions by holding the shift button and then pressing a pad. Each of these different functions is displayed below the pad with a box surrounding the text. Shift and pad 1 will turn on fixed velocity. With this on, sounds will trigger at full volume no matter how hard you hit the pad. The 16 velocity function spreads your chosen sample over the pads at 16 different volume levels, ranging from low to high. This allows you to enter sounds at different volumes to create a more human sounding pattern. So here I have a hi-hat, and I'm going to play that over my melodic sample using the 16 velocity function. So I'm going to start my sample playing. I'm going to choose my hi-hat, and then I'm going to enter 16 velocity mode by pressing pad 2. Now I can play my sample at different velocities. To record this, we press resample and then choose a pad to record to. I'm going to choose pad 3. Then, as soon as we press a pad, it will start recording. Then just press record to end the recording. Now you'll hear on pad 3, I have my sample with my hi-hat played at different velocities over the top. Shift and pad 3 is Q. This allows you to hear sounds through the headphones without them playing out of the main output. This is very useful for live performances. You will know when you are in Q mode because the pads will light up green. Another awesome feature that's been added in the new SP is the chromatic mode. It works in a very similar way to the 16 velocity mode, and allows you to play your samples melodically using the pads. For example, if I have a sound like this, and I want to play it like an instrument, I can then hold shift and press pad 4, and I enter chromatic mode, where I can play the sound melodically. You can also change the pitch of the root note by using the value knob. Turning the value knob on its own will shift 4 semitones, and turning the value knob whilst holding shift will shift 1 semitone. The chromatic mode becomes really useful when you want to record a sound over the top of another loop. So, for example, here I have my drum loop, and I want to record my bass hit over the top of the loop. So I start my loop playing. Then I press the bass, then I press shift and 4 to enter chromatic mode. And now I can play my bass melodically over the top of my loop. Now when I'm ready to record, I press resample and choose a pad to record to. Now my recording will begin as soon as I press another pad. I can then just press record to end the recording. So now we have our drum loop with our bass line recorded over the top of it on pad 2. At launch, this function is only available in resample mode. But you always have the options of recording your patterns to a pad or using the skip back functions I mentioned earlier. These will capture your audio from your patterns to a pad to work on further. Exchange allows us to swap or exchange sounds between pads. So if I want to swap the sound on pad 5 with the sound on pad 6, if I press Shift and pad 5, all of the pads will begin to blink pink. I can now press pad 5 and it will show that I've selected D5 on the screen, and then press pad 6, which will then say D6 on the screen. And now if I press in the value knob or press copy, this will exchange the two sounds. In its param, we'll reset all of the settings of your current sound. So for example, if I play this sound, and then I go into the pitch and speed menu, turn the pitch right up, reverse it. Now if I exit out and press Shift and pad 6, that's okay. Now instantly we're back to the original sound. Pad Link allows you to play multiple pads by pressing just one pad. You can use this to layer up single hits or play several loops at once. For example, I want these three sounds to play together when I press just one pad. So if I press Shift and pad 7, it brings up the Pad Link menu. And from here, I can just press the pads I would like to link. You can see these pads now flash red. Then we just press exit, and then when we press one of the three pads, all of the pads will trigger together. Mute groups allow you to assign sounds to groups. Sounds that are in the same group will cut each other off when played together. This is a very useful function when you want to choke an open hi-hat, for example, or for replaying a chopped up sample. So here I have a sample which has been chopped over four pads. As you can hear, when I play the sample now, all of the sounds play over the top of each other. But now if I press Shift and pad 8, we enter the mute group menu. Now I just press the pads that have my samples, and this will add these to a mute group. So now when I play my samples, they will all cut each other or mute each other. You can have a total of 10 different mute groups and a total of 16 samples in each group. Samples in mute groups do not need to be in the same banks. They can also be split over several different banks. Shift and pad 9 will turn the metronome on or off. On pad 10, we have the count-in settings. Count-in will designate the count-in type and whether the metronome will play at all. We have count-in off, which will start recording as soon as you press the record button. Count-in one measure, which gives you one bar before recording starts. Count-in two measures is two bars before the recording starts. Count-in wait, this will start recording when an input signal over a certain level is detected. The recording trigger is set within the utility menu under the general tab. If you press Shift and pad 11, this opens up the tap tempo menu. Here you can change the BPM by bank. You can choose each bank by pressing the bank button and manually change the BPM by turning the value knob. You can also change the BPM by tapping the sub pad. This setting is useful because it is the BPM that all the sounds in the corresponding bank will sync to when using BPM sync. So for example, if I move to bank D here and I leave this at 86 BPM, when I exit, if I press this sound, you can see it's at 72 BPM. If I BPM sync it, it will jump straight to 86 BPM. This is really useful for people performing. who can keep the energy up in their set with instant tempo changes between banks. Also, it's useful for people working with loops, as this makes it much easier to sync your samples to a master bank BPM, so they will all play at the same speed. For example, I have this drum loop, and I have this sample. But if I play them together, you will hear they are out of time with each other. But now, if I go to my second sample and BPM sync it, so they're both at 86 BPM, now when I play them together, they will both be in time. You can press Shift and Pad 12 to enter the Gain menu. Here you can change several settings related to sound coming into and exiting the SP. The first setting is the attenuator. Turn this on when the incoming signal is too hot and distorted, even when the volume of the device connected to the line in is adjusted. By activating the attenuator, you can reduce the level within the SP to avoid clipping. The next is noise gate. This is a noise gate on the guitar and mic input at the front, which you can set to avoid recording any dead air. Below this, you can adjust the gain for the line out, the headphones, or the USB out. I am now going to take you through the shift function of these four side buttons before I take you through the bottom row of buttons here, which I will cover in the next section. At the top here, we have the mute bus. With this on, any sounds going through either of the effects buses will be muted. For example, if I play this sample on pad 1, which is going to the effects buses, you can see this because it's illuminated orange. Even if there's no effect active, if I play this and press mute bus, it will mute that sound. If I remove this sound from the effects buses and make it dry by pressing remain and pad 1, you can see the sample is dry because it's illuminated white. If I play the sample and activate the mute bus, it will not have any effect. Next, under the hold button, we have pause. This does exactly what it sounds like. It pauses any playing audio. So if I play my drum loop and activate pause, you can see it's paused because the button is flashing, and then play. Next, underneath external source, we have the input setting menu. I covered this menu in depth in a previous section, recording an instrument. So if you are unsure of any settings, please refer to that section. At the bottom, we have the project menu. If you press Shift and Subpad, it will bring up the menu. Here, you can load up any of your saved projects by just pressing a pad. You can delete projects using Delete, or you can copy projects by using Copy. The new SP can store a total of 16 projects, and each project is a completely new set of banks and samples. Essentially, it's like you have access to 16 different SPs from one unit. Pressing Shift and Pad 13 will open up the utility menu. Within this menu, you can actually change the settings of the complete bottom row of pads. So I'm going to be doing this complete bottom row from inside the menu. You can select an item by using the value knob and then load up that menu by pushing in the value knob. So here we are in the General tab. At the top of the General tab, it has the settings for the control knobs. Edit knob mode is the setting that will be used when you are using your control knobs to edit your samples. Direct means that whenever you move the knob, the cursor will instantly jump to that value. Catch mode means that the knob has to be moved backward or forward to the previous parameter setting before the knob movement will take control of the parameter. The EFX knob mode relates to the way that the control knobs work when editing your EFX. In direct mode, the knobs will jump to the parameter set by the knob straight away. And when you leave an effect, it will save those settings. This is the same way that the control knobs worked on the previous SP404 models. In catch mode, the knobs have to be moved to their original parameter before the knob will take control of the effect. And now we have the all-new manual mode. This means that whenever you move a knob, the effect parameters will be changed in the background. This allows you to set the knob settings before you enable the effects, giving advanced users complete control. The Load Project mode allows you to choose which project loads on startup. You can choose it to load the last project you are working on or any one of your saved 16 projects. Subpad mode. This allows you to choose the function of the subpad. It can be used for its original mode, where it re-triggers the last pad pressed, or you can change it to trigger the skip back sampling function. Auto trigger level. This is where you set the level that will trigger auto recording when recording from an external source. Screensaver time is where you can set how long it will take before the screensaver starts. Screensaver type is where you can choose from different screensavers or load your own custom screensaver. BPM Auto Detect sets whether to automatically analyze the BPM of an audio file when they're imported. BPM Detect Range sets the BPM analysis range when importing a sample. I'm now going to use Control 3 to move over to the next tab, the Click tab. So first of all, we have Output Assign. This specifies whether the metronome is played out of the main speakers or not. Then we have Click Level. This sets the volume of the click. Then we have Metronome on Recording. So this sets whether the metronome will play after the count in the recording. Then we have Metronome in Pattern. This specifies whether the metronome will play when you're recording a pattern. Then we have counting for recording. This sets the counting parameters for the metronome when recording from an external source. And then we have counting for pattern. This sets the counting parameters for patterns. These settings were covered in more detail when I was going through the counting pad mode. Now I'm going to move over to the MIDI tab. First of all, we have MIDI sync. Here you can set whether your SP takes its MIDI synchronization from the internal clock, the MIDI input, or the USB input. Or you can leave it on auto and it will select the input that is receiving the MIDI signal. Next, we have MIDI sync out. This sets whether the SP will send its MIDI clock signal out or not. Now we have soft through. With this setting turned on, MIDI messages input from the MIDI in are output directly to the MIDI out. USB MIDI through. This setting determines whether the MIDI signals coming in from the USB or MIDI in are sent directly to the MIDI out or USB out. Next, we have the gain tab. Here you can set the parameters relating to gain. These settings were fully explained in the pad mode section under gain. I'm going to press exit now to get to the main menu and move on to the pad settings menu. Here you can change all the parameters related to your pads. In the trigger tab, you can change all the options related to your pad sensitivity. You also have several tabs which allow you to change the LED brightness and change colors for buses and individual pads. Next, we have the EFX settings screen, which is where you set all your parameters for your FX routings and additional buses. This menu was fully covered previously in the EFX section. Here we have the import-export screen. We can use this screen to move sounds and projects to and from our SD card. For example, to import a sound from our SD card, press in the value knob, choose sample. I'm going to scroll down to my samples folder on my SD card and scroll down and choose a sound. You can preview sounds by pressing the sub pad. Then choose an empty pad to export to. My only empty pad is pad 4 here. And then push in the value knob to confirm. Your sample will now be loaded onto your chosen pad. You can also export samples and projects to your SD card. Choose Export to SD card from the menu, and I'm going to choose Project. I'm going to choose Project 5, press the value knob in again. This will then save the project to the SD card to load later or to transfer to another SP404 Mark II. Next, we have the backup menu. In the backup menu, you can backup your entire SP memory and samples to the SD card. You can then use the restore option to reload your setup or transfer your complete setup to a new SP. Here we have the factory reset menu. In here, you can use the all data option. This resets your SP to factory settings, including wiping your samples. And there is also the option to just reset the system data. This will only reset your SP system without deleting any of your samples. A new mode has been added into the SP, and that is DJ mode. The SP series has been used for a long time by people to do live performances. And now the new DJ mode adds even more possibilities. This lets you mix together two audio files using controls similar to a DJ mixer. So here I have two of my tracks. And I'm going to mix them together in DJ mode. To enter DJ mode, press both Bank D and Bank E at the same time. And you will see on the screen now there is the new DJ mode. In here, we can adjust the volume of channel one by using Control 1. We can adjust the volume of channel two by using Control 2. And we can also adjust the cue mix from cue to master by using Control 3. The cue mix determines which source you will hear in the headphones. So to assign a track to channel 1, we enter the menu by pressing in the value knob and choosing channel 1 select. We can then choose a sound by pressing one of our pads. So I'm going to choose my track on this side and press enter. As you can see, now the first two rows of buttons have changed color. This indicates that there is a song loaded on channel one, and now the functions of these pads are available. You can see the function of each pad because it's written on the pads inside a box at the bottom. Starting from the bottom on pad 13, we have play and pause. Then we have cue. When cue is on and cue mix is on C, it allows you to hear the sound through the headphones without it coming out of the main output. Then we have rewind on pad 9, which takes us back to the start of the track. Next, you have sync. This allows us to synchronize both tracks at the same BPM. But to use this function correctly, you must make sure your tracks have been analyzed at the correct BPM. Then above on 1 and 5, we have BPM bend. This helps us momentarily increase the BPM or reduce it slightly. This can help when trying to line up tracks in the mix. And then we have BPM plus and BPM minus. These increase or reduce the overall BPM of your track. We can now load a sound on channel 2 in the same way, but choosing channel 2 select from the menu. Then choose our track. The second track has now loaded up on the right-hand side using these two columns, but with exactly the same functions as the left-hand side. You can now use the controls on each side to sync your tracks and mix them together. The first thing I'm going to do is sync the tracks together by pressing the sync button. Now you can see both the tracks are 125 BPM. Now I'm going to turn up the volume of the track on the left, and I'm going to turn up the volume of the track on the right. I'm going to start the left-hand track playing by pressing play down here, but I'm also going to press play on the right-hand track, and I'm going to press the rewind button, which will restart my track from the start so I can drop it in time. Normally, I would do this with the cue setting on for this track and the volume down so you couldn't hear it in the mix. But for this demonstration, I'm going to leave the volume up so you can hear what I'm doing. I'm going to start this track playing. And I'm going to drop it in. Now we can bend the pitch a little bit. So now both tracks are playing in time. I'm going to start to reduce the volume. slowly bringing track two out of the mix, and then swap completely over to the right hand side. So there you go, guys, that is how you mix two tracks together using the all new DJ Mode. On the back of the SP, we now have TRS MIDI in and out. This enables the SP404 Mark II to be triggered via MIDI and also allows it to send MIDI information. To use these ports, you will need a TRS MIDI cable. Our brother company, Boss, makes a range of TRS MIDI cables which will work perfectly with the SP404 Mark II. Right now, I am actually using the Boss B-MIDI 535. To trigger the SP via MIDI, plug the TRS end of the MIDI cable into the MIDI in input on the back of the SP. Then take the 5-pin MIDI connector on the other end and plug it into your MIDI-enabled device. Here, I am using the Roland MC-101 to trigger the SP. So if I go onto my MC-101, I am on track one, which is sending MIDI channel one. And this note here is C1. So if I press C1, you will see that pad 13 on the SP triggers. We can now go up the keyboard, triggering the pads in succession. If you would like to trigger the pads in the next bank, bank B, you need to change to MIDI channel 2, and the same keys will trigger the same pads on the next bank. Here I am set up with track 2 as MIDI channel 2, so if I press that and I move over to bank B, you will see that the same notes on the MC-101 trigger the same pads but in the second bank. These numbers will correlate all the way through. So bank A is MIDI channel 1, bank B is MIDI channel 2, all the way up to bank J, which is on MIDI channel 10. You can then use your connected piece of hardware to create MIDI patterns and trigger samples on the SP. To use the SP404 Mark II to trigger an external instrument, insert the TRS cable into the MIDI out on the back of the SP and plug the 5-pin MIDI connector into the MIDI instrument you would like to trigger. In this case, it's going to be my MC-101. In a similar way to the MIDI in scenario, bank A will trigger MIDI channel 1, pad 13 will play C1, pad 14 will play C sharp 1, pad 15 will play D1, and so on. And then bank B will trigger MIDI channel 2, with the pads playing the same notes, 13 starting at C1. The banks will then correspond to the MIDI channels in the same way as the MIDI in scenario, with bank A being MIDI channel 1, all the way up to bank J being MIDI channel 10. The new SP Mark II uses a generic USB driver, so there is no need for a separate driver install. Just simply connect to your computer using the USB-C port on the back of the unit, and you will now be able to select the SP as a device in your DAW preferences. And you will have the ability to send audio and MIDI back and forth from your computer to the SP. The SP404 Mark II will work with any DAW capable of sending MIDI messages. But for this example, I'm going to be using Ableton. So let's open up Ableton. Then open up your preferences menu by pressing Command and the comma key on a Mac or Control and the comma key on a PC. Next, go to the MIDI tab and find the SP404 Mark II in the menu. and turn on track, sync, and remote for both the input and the output. Go into the Audio tab under Audio Input Device and choose SP404 Mark II. Now, if you go down to your audio tracks and turn on Monitor In for both audio track 1 and 2, you will hear the stereo audio signal coming from your SP. To trigger the pads on your SP via MIDI, go to a MIDI track and choose the SP as the output device. You can use the SP404 Mark II as an effects processing unit to add the classic SP effects to tracks made on your DAW or a piece of external hardware. First, I'm going to show you how to add effects processing to a piece of hardware. Here, I'm going to be playing a track from my MC101. So first, I've taken the output of my MC101 and routed it to the input of my SP404 Mark II. In this case, I'm going into the line inputs on the back. Then if we turn the external source button on, if we press play on the MC101, we will hear the track from the MC101 playing through the SP. We can then use the effects controls on the SP to add effects to our MC101 track. To use the SP404 Mark II as an external FX processor with your DAW, you can use the same technique as with the hardware, using audio cables from the DAW, or instead you can use a USB cable to send your audio. To do this, plug a USB cable from the USB-C port in the back of your SP to your computer. Then in your DAW of choice, I'm using Presonus Studio One here, select the SP in the audio preferences as your playback and your recording device. Then, when you turn on the external source button, you will hear the track from your DAW playing through the SP. You can then use the effects controls to add classic SP effects to your DAW audio.
This is Soul.
The SP404 Mark II has a companion software app for your computer, which allows you to access a lot of functions on your SP. These include loading MIDI files, importing and exporting samples, and also the ability to convert your old SP404A and SX projects to use with the Mark II. To get the software app, sign up for a Roland Cloud account, register your SP, download the Roland Cloud Manager, and then you will be able to download the app from there. To use the software editor, connect your SP to the computer using a USB cable from the USB-C port on the back. Open up the SP404 Mark II app on your computer, then click Connect at the bottom of the software window. As you can see, the screen will now change and show you all the samples you have loaded on your SP. When you press a pad on the SP, you will see the sample loaded on that pad. You can preview it by pressing the preview button on the editor or by pressing the pad on the SP. To change banks, click into a different bank on the editor or use the bank buttons on your SP. You can change the settings of your sounds in the sample editor area at the top right. These include level and balance settings. On the next tab, we have mute groups and pad links. There's time stretching and also envelope settings and lots, lots more. To import a sample to the SP, simply choose a sample from your computer and drag and drop it onto a pad. This will import the sample and also detect the BPM. The sample will now be loaded on that pad on your SP. You can preview the sound by pressing preview on the editor or press the pad on your SP. You can also delete sounds by dragging them to the bin icon or export sounds to your computer using the arrow icon. You can adjust the settings of your current sound on the waveform viewer at the top of the editor. Here you can change the start and end points. And if I turn on loop settings on my SP, the loop point. You can also use the buttons at the bottom of the window to process your sample. The buttons at the top of the banks allow you to initialize a project, which will completely clear the project, import a project from your computer to the SP, or export a project from your SP to your computer. At the right-hand side, you can also access a drop-down menu, which will change the information displayed on the bank view. Here, you can choose to see which mute group samples are in, which samples are pad-linked, and lots more. At the bottom of the editor, you can also access information related to patterns and also adjust settings for entire banks. On the bottom right, you can change app settings, including changing color schemes and loading your own custom backgrounds. This has been a quick overview of the SP404 Mark II editor. If you would like more information, please visit the Roland.com website. So there we go, guys. That is the SP404 Mark II. If you have any more questions about any of the functions on the new model, please download the full manual from the Roland.com website. And be sure to register your SP404 Mark II for all of the latest info. Thanks a lot for listening. I really hope you enjoy your new SP404 Mark II. See you next time.